Good evening.
Amen.
She'd make a good over the road truck driver. My dad did that 3 years. He was an over the road truck driver. I know all about that. That's a hard profession on your family.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was tough. Tomorrow is our last children's deliverance service of the year. Man, the Holy Ghost hits these kids. It's beautiful to watch. If you've never seen one of these, you might want to just come and watch it. It's a simple process, really. You get the permission of who's ever in charge of the child and get their okay to pray for them, and then you go right after the spirits. It's not like adults where you gotta find out if they've repented or not. There's extra grace for kids, so the demons just start coming out.
Yeah.
And sometimes they get fussy, but hey, as soon as you explain to them you got permission of the parents, they go, oh crap, they're beat, and they just start coming out of the kids. A lot of them come out with lots of tears. They come out that way. It's a little different than adults, but man, it's beautiful to see. You see some kid running around like a psycho, and then they're sitting there quiet and calm. You know, it's like a miracle. We also try to use the service as a method to get to the parents, because the kid usually got the spirits through the parents. And some of the parents, they just want you to wave a magic wand over their kid and fix them. Then they want to out the door. No, the kid's just going to get reinfected. So I always try to get the parents to repent first before I start on the kids. And sometimes the Lord will touch the parents first. And when that happens, the kid's easy bake oven. Their defenses are broken.
Amen.
Holy Ghost just poof, plows them out of there. Plowing. Yeah. All right. Tomorrow at 10 o'clock. That's our last one for the year. Kids going back to school. So.
What ages?
Preteens. Yeah. Okay. Teenagers come to the adult classes. Come Thursday to Rick's class here. That thing is booming. And we just do the preteens and the children's deliverance. Okay. Thanks for bringing your kids. And, you know, don't drive by a playground and just grab a kid, because you got to have permission, you know, from the person that has the authority, spiritual authority over the kid. So if you just drag in a stranger or a homeless kid, you know, that may not go well. I have done that before years ago without getting permission, and there's been a lot of manifestations. Kid freaking and going nuts and not much productivity. So we need a parent, a guardian, a relative, a foster parent, an adopted parent, natural parents, anything like that, we're good to go. But not a temporary kidnapping. Don't go to your neighbor and go, hey, is Bobby going to be around in the yard tomorrow? Yeah, he's playing out there. Boop, you dash off with Bobby. No. We don't want the cops coming here. The cops belong at your house, not here. All right, well, that was inspirational. Let's get to our teaching tonight. Our next seminar is August 30th. There's my new radio schedule. I'm on every day of the week and on weekends there on the radio here locally. I'm on 24/7. You can pick this up off the website, catch the radio program. I had, 72,000 people last week on my Dark Sky Radio broadcast. That's going well. 7 nights a week at 9 o'clock. Amazon is taking over the planet Earth. I thought, well, I might as well join them. Nothing I can do to stop them. So if you want to help out our ministry, just put in smileamazon.com and put in our ministry name. And then if you buy something, they'll give us 1.2% of everything you spend. They send us a check once a year. I usually use it to pay the light bill during the summer, electric bill. Our electric bill here like triples or quadruples during the summer. Obviously, everybody else. Thank you. There's our YouTube teaching channels. Tonight's teaching will be on number one. You can get self-delivered at home if you send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com. You can also pick it up off the website for a Christian to be delivered if they can't come here. Not everybody can drive 27 hours and taking virtually no breaks. Okay, that's very odd. Yes, so some people, yeah, big time. So we need to put her on the staff quickly before she gets away. All right, those are the three books I wrote. They're in the bookstore, one on healing, one on mental illness healing, and one on the devil. Rick's service here Thursday nights is exploding. Man, the anointing's fantastic. You gotta come see this. That's our main service of the week, really. It's super powered. 7 o'clock Thursday nights. Our mental illness healing class is struggling. As you might imagine, it's difficult to corral mentally ill Christians. It's difficult to corral non-mentally ill Christians. But you can bring them here and they can start their healing process. They can be cured. I've had dozens of mentally ill Christians healed at the House of Healing and now here at the Deliverance Center. Come Thursday nights at 7 o'clock. Thank you for your donations. The boxes are on the doors. You can donate on the website to help us out. Thank you. I'll be on Omega Man Radio next Wednesday at 7 o'clock. Excuse me, 9 p.m. Pacific time, our time. All right, let's take a trip together. The devil is easy to spot on the big stuff. You don't even need any discernment. There'll be wars and rumors of wars. There'll be pestilences. They just had one in Las Vegas. Did you see all those grasshoppers in Vegas? Can you believe that? I've heard grasshoppers are good eating. Just put them on the buffet at the Sahara up there. They're free. Just open the window in the kitchen and load the bucket up. All that stuff's easy to spot. The stuff that's not easy to spot is what I'm putting in my teaching on Satan, my Satan secrets. These are the ones that catch Christians constantly off guard. Disappointments are something 100% of all human beings have to face on this planet. Doesn't have anything to do with your race or nationality or your who you sex, nothing. If you're a human being, you have to go through numerous disappointments in life. Huh? They fall into different categories. I'm not going to get into that. There's the self-induced catastrophes that lead to disappointments. They're the ones that you didn't do one thing. Everything falls apart. Boom, there's a disappointment. But in Christianity, the devil uses these tools very subtly. He's very bright. When I mean the devil, I'm not talking about the devil himself. He's not going to ever show up here, but he actually is here through his emissaries. Demons carry out his work in strict fashion. And so when I say the devil, that's what I mean, obviously. I don't mean him personally standing here. He's not going to come here tonight. But his demons are here. And if there's any demons here tonight, I'm glad you showed up for your butt whipping. They'll be flying out of people, and that's a Holy Ghost does that. I don't do that. Yeah. Disappointments, man, they are absolutely required, practically. They're an absolute virtually a necessity. Nobody gets out of it. I mean, nobody. Nobody goes through life having no disappointments. It's not even possible. There are some people that don't have any disappointments. Child, it's a miscarriage. They go right to heaven. They never had a disappointment. I'm talking about people that make it. Okay? You following me? The island of disappointments, the devil takes everybody there. Everybody goes. Okay? The island of disappointments is right near this island. They're in the same hemisphere. This is a movie I watch every year. Rudolph. The Red-Nosed Reindeer. You ever seen that movie? I watched it when I was a kid. Every time I watch that movie, I feel like I'm young again. It's weird. I kind of sit there like a third grader and watch it. And I have a sense of joy. It's strange. Could be a sickness. But anyway, let's take a look at some of the ways the devil subtly, inadvertently, quietly uses this technique on people. He's brilliant at it, but if you catch him at it, if you know how he does it, you can beat him. Yeah? Hopefully I'm going to do a little help in that area. Mary, Martha, and the Jews. It says, John chapter 11. This is the most amazing chapter probably in the entire Bible. It says, when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had been in the grave for 4 days. Now, you know the story of Lazarus. Everybody reads this. He was a good friend of Jesus. My guess is they grew up together in Nazareth. They were like best of friends. Jesus had a few people in his inner circle who were his closer friends. He had a few disciples that were in an inner circle that were closer to him than the others, just like any other human being has. Now, Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs. That's the Greek word stadion. And it's about an eighth of a mile. Okay, so we're talking about just a couple of miles away. You know, close. And as you know, Jesus delayed his return to Bethany. Remember? And there was a reason for that, for obvious reasons. Jesus wanted him to be in the grave for 4 days because it was a Jewish tradition that the spirit didn't leave the body until after the third day of the death of the person. So up to the third day, this is in the according to the Jews, you could still go to the grave, the spirit was still there. So they would mourn, they would have services, visitations, different things. But on the fourth day, all the Jews said, there's no point in going back to the grave or the sepulcher, they're gone. So Jesus wanted to wait 4 days to overcome this false teaching and to make absolutely sure there was no chance there could be anybody could say that he resurrected somebody who was still there. Right. He wanted the body dead in their minds. It was already dead 5 minutes or whatever it is after Lazarus died. Okay, I don't know how long it takes to transition out of your body into glory. There's a lot of after-death experiences. But 4 days, it's over, period. And many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Why? Because the family had sunk into a giant vat of demonic disappointment. The devil took the whole family. The whole family was soaked in disappointment. Why? They were disappointed in God. That's very common for Christians. I've done it before myself, of course. God is really, at times, a huge bummer. Christians blame stuff on God, and they're so disappointed in him sometimes. Mary and Martha were no exception. Everybody was talking about it at her house. You know something? Where was Jesus when did you get the message to him? Did you send the guy in runner in time? Yeah, we did. Well, where is he? Why didn't he show up? So the devil then scoops in using your expectations against you. He uses your expectations for God against you. They knew Jesus, who he was, and they believed in him. This isn't a situation of unbelief. It's a trick of demonic disappointment.
Yes.
They knew Jesus could heal him. There was no question about that. They had 100% faith in him. But their disappointment now had caused their faith to end. After 4 days, they no longer had faith that God could help. And they were disappointed in God. Not themselves, not their neighbors, not the death, not Lazarus. They were disappointed in Jesus. Very common for born-again Christians. He never showed up. He didn't show up in time. Yeah. You ever ask one of your kids to run an errand for you? Might as well be asking a chair to do it. They're not going to show up. Well, there's a tinge of disappointment there with the parent. You said you, we talked about, we went over, disappointments everywhere in life. Mary and Martha are soaked in disappointments. This was worse than anything they'd ever faced before because Jesus and Lazarus were tight. He was his best friend of sorts. They had grown up together. They had gone through all kinds of things together. They loved each other. They were the best of friends. If you have any childhood friends that you still are acquainted with, you kind of know what they were going through there. They were tight. So the devil's telling him, hey, listen, Martha, Mary, come here, honey. If Jesus loved him so much, he would have been here. Hey, that's a sign that he didn't really love him. You got the message to him in time, didn't you? Oh, I know we did. Well, then, where in God's name is he? He's not here. Oh, man. He was too busy for me. He was gone too long. He didn't really care. All of these thoughts were being placed in their minds by spirits. Every time you have a disappointment, the spirits attack you with these exact thoughts. They start putting them into your mind in an attempt to cause your faith to collapse. It's exactly what happened to Mary and Martha. The Jews were helping them too. They were all disappointed. They had a house full of mourners. They were all disappointed. It was like a disappointment convention. Everybody was disappointed in God. Everybody was disappointed he died. He should have never died, for crying out loud. He knew the Messiah, the Moshiach, the Christos, personally. I mean, you can't get any more help than that, can you? They were personal friends. This isn't a regular disappointment. This is on steroids disappointment. This is a monumental disappointment to this family. And who are they disappointed at? The mortician, God. God, whom they trusted, let them down. God let them down. Martha, as soon as she heard Jesus was there, she ran out to meet him. But Mary didn't hear about it, so she stayed in the house, remember? And then she said what she had been telling everybody else. She revealed a conversation she and Martha had had several times since he died. She told him how she really felt. She told him what they had told the Jews. Everybody at her house had repeated this concept. You know, if you had been here, if you'd have just made it, if you weren't a screw-up, if you cared, you would have showed up in time. That's a human condition, not just a Christian one. You're supposed to be to work on time. You know, you're supposed to be to dinner on time. You're supposed to be celebrating Christmas. Everything's on time. This is a time-oriented world. And when you're not on time, that's disrespectful. You know anybody that's chronically late? Every time they finally show up, you have an urge. You fight it down, but your hands start to move into a choke position. Has that ever happened to you? You fight it back. But it's very disappointing when someone tells you, hey, I'll be there at 7 o'clock. They show up at 7:40, 7:25, 7:50. You know, it's this urge, like, my God, I should have got my permit to carry. It's frustrating. It's hurtful when somebody doesn't show up on time. And Jesus, in their minds, being now a screw-up like everybody else, doesn't bother to show up on time. Correct?
Yeah.
I hope I'm reading this right.
Yeah.
If you'd have been there, if, see that if? If means your faith tanked. As soon as you use the word if around the Lord, you can interpret that as your faith being gone. Hello? The demon-possessed boy and his father said to Jesus, if you can do anything, have compassion on us. What was going on there? The father had so many disappointments. He had so many faith healers praying for his boy. He had so many Pharisees and scribes. They went to witch doctors. They went to seances. They did everything they could to save that boy's life. That man lived a lifetime of chronic disappointments. Because in the story, the boy had been that way as an infant, if you read the Greek text. He'd been that way since he was an infant. They had suffered for years, chronic disappointments. So he then said, oh God, I'm trying to believe. I've got some faith. I know I do. But Lord, if you can help, if you can do it. As soon as you hear the word if, your prayers are in trouble. Why? It means that doubt has crept in. And if is a doubt collector.
Yeah.
Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. But now I know, even now, whatever you ask of God, God will give it to you. Here's the danger of the Word of Faith movement. It causes you to say crazy spiritual things. The Word of Faith position is, you've got to pump yourself up and quote that scripture and make that statement and do this one. Well, Martha makes the mistake of going Word of Faith on the thing. It backfires on her. I know you're from God. And whatever you ask God, he'll give it to you. Oops, she shouldn't have said that. Because Jesus drops a bomb right in your face. Your brother will rise again. Oops, I didn't mean that much Word of Faith. See, with the Word of Faith stuff only goes so far. Usually it's about stuff that can't be proven now, okay. Word of faith. God's going to get your job, brother. It's only, you know, that gets you off the hook. See, you know, the job is down the road, so I can blab it here. Well, she blabbed it there and got it stuck right in her face. Now she's panicking. Oh, okay. I think the Lord is cracking up. I'll let him off the hook. Lord, I know he'll raise from the dead at the resurrection. See, she's letting Jesus off the hook. She's trying to help him. She's giving him an out. Have you ever given somebody else an out? I don't mean the divorce. I mean personal things going on. You give somebody an out, how to get out of a mess, particularly a kid. Jesus said, wait a minute. I'm the resurrection and the life. That's the Greek word zoe. It's the noun. It means to be alive. I have zoe tonight. I am physically alive. And I'm spiritually alive. I'm born again. Then he says, he that believes in me, though they were dead, yet shall they zao. That's the verb of zoe. That means they're living. They're living their life. Whoever believes in me, yet shall he live. Okay? What's he talking about? It's spiritual. Whoever, zao, here we go again, is living life, and believes in me shall never die. That's 100% true. If you're a born-again Christian, you will never face spiritual death.
That's true.
Never.
That's true.
You do not die and go to hell. You don't go to purgatory. You go home when you're dead. That's exactly what he said. Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who should come into the world. Now she's really scared. Because that verse in the Bible is the most important and the most powerful verse anywhere in the New Testament or Old. It is the greatest single verse in the Bible. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? He says to her. She goes, holy crap, I got to get out of here. So she gives him a dump, quick word of faith dump. But I know you're the Christ, the Son of God. See ya. Boom, she bolts. When she said that, she turned around and ran for home. Then she goes and gets Mary. She says, hey, come here, Mary. Over here, sweetie. Jesus asked about you. I just saw him. Why don't you go see him? I'll stay here. So she figures, hey, if I got to face that, she ought to face it. She last week, she wasn't helping me fix dinner. She was down listening to see paybacks or something. She calls her secretly, but she gets spotted. She's spotted heading out, right? The master's calling for you. When Mary came to Jesus and saw him, she fell down at his feet. Okay, what's this telling us? The disappointment here was monumental. Some disappointments are, oh, nuts, that didn't work out. I'll go on to the next loss. Some of them are catastrophic disappointments. They couldn't. It seems like they couldn't be any worse. This was one of them. She falls down at her feet saying what? What they had been discussing for days at their home. The devil had them chirping at home. You know, if he'd have just been there, you see, you can't trust Jesus, can you? You put your faith in him, didn't you? He didn't show up, did he? He screws up too, doesn't he? And everybody was agreeing, oh yeah, he's not here. Yeah, he never showed up. Oh my goodness. Lord, if you'd have just been here, that was the main theme of the disappointment ship at their house. My brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, that's the Greek word klio. It means to have a crying jag. You ever had one of those? Not just a cry, I mean a wailing cry. You ever had one? That's what that means, klio, heaving crying. Wailing, crying. Okay? And it says, the Jews were also weeping. They were wailing. So up comes Mary, and up comes the Jews following her. And everybody's crying like crazy. It's a massive scene of everybody wailing. Very uncomfortable. Can you say the word awkward? I mean, that's painful when everybody is wailing, okay? I have never even had that. See? Yeah. Sometimes I've had some teachings that didn't go over well. There were a few people weeping. Nobody wailing. I wasn't even that bad. What did Jesus do? Well, this part is really interesting. Embrimaomai is to snort like a bull. He sees all these wailers and he gets fussy. A fussy savior. Not the reaction you would have thought. See, and you'd have never got that from just reading the King James text. Would you have? No. No, you wouldn't have. Tarasso, he's agitated. Okay? He's, what? Kind of like you when somebody insulted you. Ever had that happen? You know what? You suck, buddy. What? You kind of give that snort. Your spouse recognizes it and keeps laughing. When you're around a hippopotamus and you see that water coming up, you better find higher ground quickly. Hello? Now, I don't hang around many bulls, but if I saw one looking at me snorting, I'd be out the door. Why? Because I know somebody's about to get their butts kicked. And when Jesus snorted, the devil heard him. He goes, oh my God, I'm about to get my butt kicked. See, when the Holy Ghost gets in one of his moods, your demons get their faces kicked in. When they hear that snort, they start panicking. We call it manifesting. They start manifesting because they're scared. You know why? They heard something you didn't in the spirit world. They heard the Holy Ghost go, I'm very tired. I'm very tired of you persecuting that child of God. The demons start manifesting. And you thought it was you. He snorts it out and he goes, where is he? Where's the dead guy? They said, Lord, come and see. And Jesus does what? Not Clio, but he did not do it. The cruel means to weep a little few tears, like you would at a funeral or something. Like you would when you were getting married. Remember that? Yeah. It happened to me once. I'd been having a little bit too much to drink in Las Vegas. Shouldn't have done that. Don't do that. That's a public service announcement. So don't go to Las Vegas. Jesus started crying. Why? Why was he starting crying? Well, there's a number of options here. He was feeling hopeless. He couldn't do anything about the situation. The devil had complete command. Oh, no, none of those fit, friend. None of those fit. What he was weeping at, in my opinion, this is only my opinion, I can't prove it. I think it was the sorrow he saw of the results of sin. The results of Adam destroying us. His best friend was rotting in the sepulcher. All these people around him are wailing and crying. Everybody's sad. They're all looking at him like he's a failure. Sin causes you to look at God like he's a failure. And that's, I think, why he was weeping. You may have a better idea. The Jews had this idea. Oh my goodness, look how much he loved him. Oh, wow. How'd that go over? It went over real bad. Some said, could not this man which opened the eyes of the blind, could he have kept this person from dying? Well, that's a slap in the face for the Holy Ghost. That's an insult to God right there. They're insulting him. They're wailing, they're moaning, and they're looking at Jesus and misinterpreting his tears. Nobody likes that. Guess what happened? There it was again. That Holy Ghost snort came out. He's agitated, frustrated, angry. Whenever you hear that snort from an animal, you better be careful, Harry. You better get the heck out of there. And in the spirit world, the demons saw him snort. And they said, oh my God. So he comes to the grave, and guess there was a stone laid upon it, and guess what happened? Nobody was disappointed anymore. What's the purpose of that story? Well, there's several of them, but the main one is, you may have a disappointment, and you may have blamed God for that, but you can repent and still get your miracle. Everybody had sinned and doubted him and falsely accused him and got mad at him and saw the disappointment in God, and he forgave them. And Lazarus comes stumbling out of the tomb, wrapped up in grave clothes, looking like an extra from a Vincent Price movie. He said, loose him and let him go. What was he doing? Let go of the disappointments and the sorrows you've been carrying around for years. I want you to release those tonight at this altar call. I want you to let them go.
Yes.
Because if you'll do that, you'll get a Lazarus waiting just around the bend. If they'd have kept their disappointments and refused to listen, he would have said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said, "None of your business." That's what a backslider does. They get embittered and frustrated with God because he won't do it the way they want it done.
Right.
So they get a little pissed off at him. You're supposed to be getting pissed off at demons, not God, friend. Follow Jesus' example. Use that Holy Ghost snort tonight. How dare you turn my daughter into a drug addict? How dare you turn my son heroin addict? How dare you? How dare you foreclose on my home? How dare you steal my job? How dare you attack my family? Hey, if you'll get a little snort, you'll get an anointing tonight. And you'll have a Lazarus miracle right around the corner.
Yeah.
It's right there. I read it. Cain! What a great story this is. Let's go to Genesis chapter 4. Eve bore a son, and she bore Cain, and she bore Abel. Now, I want to caution you about this Genesis stuff. Be careful with this book of Genesis, particularly in the beginning. Everybody misinterprets it because they assume things. Okay, so don't, when you read it next time, don't assume anything because you're going to end up in a bad place. Back then, people lived unbelievable amounts of years. Now the average is what, 73, 74 for life expectancy? Scott, what?
It's in the 70s.
In the 70s.
74.
Yeah, back then it was like 674, right? 974. I missed it by 300. What's going on around here? Okay, so we don't know how much time there was between Cain and Abel. We don't know how many kids were born between Cain and Abel. We don't know how many kids were born before Cain and Abel, but we do know when Cain left for his banishment, there was already another city of people over there. Hello? Okay, back then, you just married your sister or your brother. Okay? That's how it was back then. So we know that there were, you know, potentially dozens or hundreds of years between these events. Okay? When you read Genesis 1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, and verse 2 says, the earth was without form and void. You don't know how many years there were between that verse and this verse. It doesn't say. Hello?
Amen.
People assume that first verse was part of the 7 days. Hey, you cannot assume those things. A lot of times I'll add some cautionary stuff when I teach. It's a community service type thing. Well, Eve bore Abel, we don't know if. So, just for fun, let's just pretend they're in their 20s or 30s. I'm guessing. I have no idea. Abel was the keeper of the sheep. And Cain was a farmer, tiller of the ground, right? It came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground as an offering to the Lord. All right, Abel brought the firstlings of his flock and the fat with it. And the Lord did what? Yeah, he received Abel's offering. And he did what to Cain? To Cain and his offering, he had no respect for it. And Cain was, to say the least, disappointed. Okay? People handle their disappointment differently. Every person is different. And as a counselor for 37 years, I always take each person individualized. I never make assumptions about them. Because everybody's different. Everybody had a different background. Everybody has a different personality. Everybody has a different personality temperament. And so you have to take each person as you find them, in a way. And don't assume anything about them when they stagger into my office. I don't assume anything about them. I just start my research, bang, when they sit down. Well, everybody handles disappointments exactly like that. Everybody handles them differently. Mary and Martha were the type to whine and look for self-pity. And they didn't get mad or vicious or angry. You know, they got like, oh God, you know, why would he let us down? What's wrong with me? Why am I not worthy to be? Why can't God show up when I need him? That it's a self-pity syndrome that hits you. Cain was different. He was a perfectionist. He was a dominant. He had a dominant personality. He wanted stuff done when he wanted it done. He wanted his opinion taken over the others. He was a strong man, a fighter. He wasn't like Mary and Martha. He wasn't a server. He was a leader. He was pushy. He was a controller. He was a narcissist. He was in charge. So Cain then does what? He gets angry over what happened. Okay? We don't know how this story came about. It's very sketchy. But my assumption is that Jehovah had told him what kind of sin offering he wanted and what he would accept. That's my guess. Because they both brought that offering, and one was not what was asked for, and the other one was. Yeah? But the narcissist, the firstborn, the dominant personality, Abel was more like his mother. Cain was more like his dad. He got extremely angry over his disappointment at being rejected. Okay? Narcissists can't stand rejection. They freak. And this was a huge rejection. It was Jehovah, the great God of the universe, had rejected Cain's sin offering. Correct?
Yes.
And he was instantaneously mad. And if you ever see anybody who has a short fuse or has a quick temper, their faces are so easy to read, it's ridiculous. You don't need a master's degree in counseling like I have and 37 years of experience. Oh, no. You could be a sixth grader and look at somebody and go, whoa, that person's mad. Cain was furious, and it come right out of his personality instantaneously. Because he was a narcissist. Why are you angry? Yahweh said. What's wrong? Why is your face sunk like that? What are you furious about? Listen, if you do well, will you not be accepted? But if you don't do well, sin lies at the door. In Hebrew, it actually says sin offering. So what happened was Abel came to bring a sin offering to the Lord. He was allowed to bring it in and give it to him. God received it. Because it was what he told them to have. And Cain couldn't get in. He said, hey, no, you stop at the door. Because your offering is not what I asked for. It stays out there. The sin offering stays at the door. Cain talked with Abel, his brother, later. Once again, we have no information on this story. It's so sketchy. It's terrible. We don't know how much time has passed here. We don't know what happened between them. We don't know nothing. But here's what we do know. Cain pretended to be Abel's friend here. He's talking with his brother. Now, he couldn't have been saying, you know what? I hate your guts over that offering thing the other day. And what I'd like to do is just murder you. Come on out in the field. I don't think they had that conversation. I'm just guessing. What I think, well, he was talking nice to him. Abel, how you doing, buddy? What's up? See, narcissists don't have a conscience. If they have one, it's very damaged. Okay? So, if you're plotting to murder somebody, you just act real nice to him when you're talking to him. See, like you're married. Come on out in the field, honey. Honey, why don't you test the brakes on the car? Yeah. Take it up the Rocky Point. Don't forget your cell phone. Yeah, I'll contact you there. Cain sweet-talked him. Abel didn't know what was going on. He blew a stack at the offering ceremony, but, you know, he calmed down later. Whatever. Yeah, no problem. I'll come out in your field. Somebody didn't show up for work. Somebody's not doing something. Yeah, I'll come out and help. I'll pick this and put, you know. The Bible says in the New Testament that Abel was righteous. So my interpretation from that is he was a good guy. He was a good person. He was a God-fearing, God-loving man. Cain was the opposite. He was self-absorbed, self-centered, a narcissist, angry, had a short temper, short fuse. He was a dominant personality. If you crossed him, he remembered it and paid you back. Huh? Am I right or wrong? Uh-huh. Very similar to what we would call an ex nowadays. Okay. It says here, Cain sweet-talked him into the field. Yeah, pick those tomatoes. Boom, it says he murdered him. But he got caught. How? How did he get caught? The Bible says the life of the person is in the blood of every person. First thing they check when you go to the doctor, they want a darn blood test. They want to stick you with needles. And have you ever had a nurse that didn't know how to do that? Like a new trade school graduate over at Medical Assistant Society? They'll take two or three stabs at that sucker. It's not a fun afternoon at the doctor. Uh-uh. You ever had one miss a vein and boom, it blew? Yeah, that's a party day. Listen, Cain, come on out here, buddy. I want to talk to you for a minute. Boom, he murders him. But what was crying? Not the body, not Cain, not Abel. Abel was gone. Abel wasn't with the body anymore. It wasn't his body. It was his blood that was crying for justice to God. And when you murder somebody, that's one of the worst sins you can possibly commit, because you played God. You took somebody's life. And the blood of that person is on your hands for eternity. The blood was crying out for justice. And then Cain, who's a narcissist, who's a self-absorbed person, smarts off to God. Yeah. Very common for a Christian in America. Yeah. They'll do it. They do it all the time. Come on, brother, let's go down and pray. Oh, I did that. It's not going to happen. I've done that. He's not listening. That's not going to happen. He's not going to help me. If he'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Yeah. Some Christians get real angry at a disappointment. Some of them get self-pitied and depressed. Others of them get mad at God. They get steamed at him. You know why? Because the devil was quoting Bible verses to him. The devil causes your disappointments to accelerate by giving you God's word. He quotes the Bible to you to make you hate God more. I'm praying and praying and praying and praying. It didn't happen, so now I'm disappointed. Oh, you're disappointed. Listen, remember the word. God will always supply your needs according to his riches and glory, except you, sucker. He'll quote the word on you to get you more angry and more depressed. Why is he doing that? He's trying to show you, hey, had you been here, my brother wouldn't have died. God is unreliable. See it all the time in the deliverance ministry. People come for months and they still have all these demons in them. They can't believe it. And then they start getting angry. Well, wait a minute. Well, then the devil comes to him and says, hey, what? Something's wrong here with God. It ain't you. I mean, lay hands on the sick and they shall recover, right, sucker? And you go, that's right, yeah. I've got a scripture. God must be a screw up. I've been laid hands on till I practically suffocated. You ever been to a Pentecostal church and an altar call? Huh? Never? Don't go unless you got lots of guts. You go down that altar, like 10 people are on you. God, heal him. Come on, brother, hang on. The other one's yelling, come on, brother, let go. 6-8 people, hands on you everywhere. They go. Says it right in the Bible, right? The demons tell you, you're not delivered, are you? Oh, and the demons know it's the real problem is an attitude, a secret sin, a gripe against God. They know what the real problem is, why they haven't come out. But they're going to try to tell you, oh, God's a screw up. After all, the Bible says that, doesn't it? The devil will outquote you in the Bible any day of the week and twice on Sunday. Don't even attempt to compete with him. He knows the whole thing backwards and forwards in every language. So Cain smarts off because he's a narcissist. Hey, I don't know where he is. Narcissists lie and they don't feel it. Why? Their consciences are seared. He told God himself, I don't know where he is. He knew exactly, Eric, he knew exactly where he was. Exactly where he was. He lied. Bold-faced lie. Didn't even feel it. Didn't feel it. Nothing. What am I? A shamar? Am I a security guard following him around all the time? He smarts off. He lies, then he smarts off. I'll tell you what, you got to tip your hat to Cain. He's got some guts. Jehovah come looking for me, I'd been in a fetal position somewhere under a tree. I wouldn't be lying and smarting off. I'd be over there weeping. But I don't have the blessing of being a narcissist. Cain had a seared conscience. He was self-absorbed. He cared only for himself. It's all about Cain. Those people always end up destroyed. Always. They all end up destroyed. Why don't I follow him around as a security guard? 1 John chapter 3 tells us an interesting piece of information, does it not? This is the great apostle John. Not like Cain, who was of that wicked one, who slew his brother. Why did he slew him? Check this out. Poneros is a Greek word for perverted. Cain was a pervert who, Sfadzo, butchered his brother. He didn't kill his brother. That's the Greek word phanos. It means to murder. He slaughtered his brother. He kept hitting him with fury and hate because he was embarrassed over religion. Religion is the Ebola of humanity. Almost all wars are caused by religion. Religion is evil and wicked and created by Satan himself. This story is about religion. He murdered him over religion. And he was so angry that he had been embarrassed in front of his brother that he slaughtered him. He killed him. Viciously. You ever see that movie, Wyatt Earp? Well, about in the middle of the movie, he's got his family on the trains, and they're leaving Tombstone, or they're leaving Tucson to go to San Francisco. Get him out of the area because he feared for their lives. Did you see that movie? Well, anyway, these killers from the gang, what was the name of that gang? Dalton's. They had followed him to the train station. Well, the guy that had killed his other brother was there, and Wyatt Earp snuck up on the guy and shot him. Do you remember that scene? Nobody? Well, anyway, after he shot him, he went up to him and pulled a cane. He was so furious that that guy had murdered his other brother. He shot him 6 times in the face. That's what Cain did. He slaughtered Abel because he hated his guts, because his narcissism and the embarrassment over being humiliated over religion caused him to do something perverted. Perverted. He didn't just murder him. That's not the Greek word. Why did he do it? Because his own works were perverted, punerous. They were evil. His brother's, Abel's, was righteous. Genesis 4, let's go back. God says to him, what'd you do? Listen, the Bible says if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In order to get delivered of demons, in order to get your sins forgiven, you have to confess them. Not because God doesn't know, but he wants you to acknowledge what you did was wrong. Cain was incapable of acknowledging it. He was self-absorbed, selfish, narcissist. There's no way he could do it. He never came back to God and said, you know what, Lord? I can't believe it. I brought the wrong offering and you told me not to bring it, and I did, and I apologize. He would have been accepted back immediately. There was no reason to kill Abel. He could have been completely restored. No. The blood of Abel cried out for justice. He was still in the field. He slaughtered his body, crashed his skull in, cut him to ribbons, stabbed him multiple times, like Wyatt Earp. Why? Disappointments. People handle disappointments differently. Some people mourn. Some people look for self-pity. Some people get angry at God. And they get so mad, their conscience stops working. And other people look at them and go, why would you do that? How'd you do that? What were you thinking when you did that? Other people look at them and go, that guy's got problems. Why? Because they would never do that. What triggered it? Man, a religious disappointment. God didn't answer my prayer the way I thought he was going to answer it. God did not hear my prayer the way I thought he was going to answer it. Everybody has that. 100% of all Christians go through it. But how you react to it differs from one person to the other. The devil knows all about it. He treats each person individually. He knows how you handle your disappointments and how you handle yours. You'll get different treatment than you will. Disappointments are not the problem. It's how you handle them that becomes the problem. Oh, here's Samson. Let's take a look at him. A little background in Judges chapter 13. The Jews are screwing up again. They're backslidden. They've gone back into idolatry, and God let them go into captivity. Okay? For decades. And the Judges, the book of Judges, is the story of this backsliding nation, Israel. And they did evil again in the sight of the Lord, and Jehovah delivered them in the hands of the Philistine for 40 years. Guess what? Mercy always rejoices against judgment. You ever see God judging somebody in the Old Testament? Mercy was always around the corner. You ever notice that? Why? That's his personality. And Jehovah says, well, I'm going to have mercy on these Jewish people. He says, I'm going to come to this couple out of the blue. Just like Mary and Joseph, out of the blue, He says to the mother, hey, you shall conceive a son. Here's what happens. No razor, never cut his hair. Okay. No great clips. He will be a Nazarite to God from the womb. See the correlation here? Somebody came later who was a Nazarene from the womb. And then it says, he shall begin to deliver Israel out of the hands of the Philistines. 3,000 years later, they're still not completely delivered, but they will be someday. And I think it's going to be soon. Only a few more years away. That's my read on it. He shall begin to deliver Israel out of the hands of the Philistines. And when he was young, it says, chapter 13, the Spirit of the Lord began to move Samson at times in the camp between Zorah. And Samson, in verse chapter 14, goes down to Timnah, and that's where the Philistines lived. And he sees a hot babe down there. Probably went into a strip club, saw this gal working a pole. She was a daughter of the Philistines. And Samson, you gotta see the picture here. Here's a built, big, hormone-ridden, powerful man who, on top of that, has got the Holy Ghost that gives him supernatural strength. He could have wiped out 15 Nephilim in one fight. No comparison. Right? We're not talking about somebody who weighs 140 pounds and plays with dolls and wears skirts. This is what you would call here somebody with some machismo. Like truckloads of it. Truckloads. And Samson's got the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes running amok. Okay? He sees a hot-looking babe and boom, he's on him. And nobody's going to tell him not to get on him. To their own peril. Many people are very jealous of Samson. I'm not anymore. He saw this woman, lust of the eyes. Hello. Lust of the eyes. Lust of the flesh. Pride. I get what I want when I want. Cain is in there. Those three things have gotten people in more trouble than you could ever imagine. Well, I can raise my hand there. So he comes back. And he comes to his mother and dad. Right? He said, hey, I seen this hot babe in Timnah. And his dad goes, son, I told you not to go to Timnah. That was a similar Las Vegas. I saw one of the daughters of the Philistines. Go get her for me. Wait a minute here. Here's your typical born-again Christian mother and father. You sit down with your son or daughter and you go over what's right with them. And you explain it to them. See? You're trying to give them some wholesome homegrown values. The problem is your kids look at you like you're a certified psycho because you talk a certain way but you behave another. And your kids have eyes like hawks and they watch you, how you react to people, how you react at work, who you talk to, what you say when you're mad, what you do when, and they watch your behavior. And they don't listen to your words. So you talk yourself blue in the face over this kid. And after a while, that Greek word starts to build up there. And you kind of sense you need to get a weapon. You don't do it because that's a felony. But you'd like to, after a while, you talk to your kids, you're blue in the face, they don't listen, they do the opposite. You get to the point where you'd like to slap some sense into them. Hello? Okay. You can look at me like, what are you talking about? You know exactly what I'm talking about. When you talk a game in front of your kids, but you act another game, they will instantaneously see that. You know what they will incorporate? Your behavior, not what you said.
Right. That's right.
Yep. Who are we talking about here? Samson. Mr. Lust. Son, oh, dude, I told you not to go over there. Why'd you go over there? I felt like it. Well, what are you doing, man? Why can't you find one of these beautiful Israeli Jewish women? Samson, I mean, they're beautiful. They love Jehovah. They worship Yahweh. Why can't you do that? What is the deal? Why do you have to have lots of jewelry and fancy outfit and a pole? Why do you need a pole? Why can't you stay here and get a good girl? Don't you want a good girl? See, the problem is good girls aren't very exciting. No offense. People want a good girl, but they don't really want a good girl. Yeah. No, I don't want a good girl. I want some gal who can run around. Samson goes, I don't want one of these Jewish girls. Now that'd be the right thing to do. Not for me. I'm Samson. Look at the hormones. Look at me. See, when you get gifts from God and you get the Holy Ghost and then you start to think it's you, you are in a world of hurt. You will pay a severe price for it. Your giftings come from God. Your anointing comes from God. This isn't about you. You're not Samson. You're a servant of the Most High God. You're not an arrogant, lust-ridden monster like this guy. He goes, what? Dad, come on, man. Why do you got to take a wife? They're idolaters over there. You get mixed up with a Philistine woman, she'll betray you. I'm telling you. They worship Dagon and everybody else over there. They don't have any morals over there. What am I doing right now? I'm talking to you. You had that conversation with your daughter. Hey, Mom, I met Bob on a fishing trip. I really like him. He's funny. You spend about 10 minutes with him and you're in the bathroom vomiting. You come out and beg your daughter. You beg her. Baby, don't. Honey, I got a bad feeling about this guy. Oh, Mommy's so funny. Look, funny wears off, sucker. Wears off quick. Mama knows it wears off. Papa's snorting in the driveway. Now, yeah, you've been there. You're laughing because you know what I'm talking about. Samson didn't listen to his parents. His parents gave him good, godly advice. Had he listened, his entire miserable life would have been completely different. Typical born-again Christian, they think they know too much. Hey, I got this anointing. Boy, I'm a great preacher. No, you're not a great preacher. You've been gifted to preach. Your preaching comes from here, not where you are, dude. As soon as you start thinking your giftings are yours, whoa. Disaster ahead. He said, hey, wait a minute. He doesn't even answer this dad. Go get her for me. She's hot. Okay. What happens to Samson? Yeah. She betrays him. Yeah, he tears this lion up. Later on comes back and scoops out the hive, takes some home to his parents. I couldn't do that. I don't have a bee anointing. He just walked right up there and, honey, guess they didn't have killer bees back then, but you're still getting stung. He didn't care. He didn't even bother. He's Samson, fool. When he tells the Philistines this riddle, they couldn't figure it out. So they came to his wife. He should have never married her. His dad warned him about marrying idol-worshipping Philistinian women. They ain't no good. Yeah. You brought a gal home once. Didn't you?
Oh, yeah.
Your parents took a look at her? Yeah, they did. You heard a thunk in the kitchen? That was your mom. That was your mom fainting. She hit the deck hard. Mom, she's a good person. She got saved. She doesn't prostitute anymore. Wow. That was the only night you ever saw your mom. Just plastered drunk. Well, guess what? They went to his wife, a Philistine, whom he never should have married, and they said, you tell us that riddle, or we're going to kill your parents and burn everything you've got, and when we're done, we're going to burn you to death. Philistines were lovely people.
Yeah.
He warned them not to marry her. Why? Because when you marry someone, you get the family with it. You ain't just marrying one person. Unless you've got a home in Antarctica. Not too many people move there. He knew better than to marry her. He said, she pleases me. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh will lead you right to the gates of hell.
Yes, sir.
He takes her. He doesn't listen. She betrays him. And they get the riddle. He never has anything to do with her again. Of course, Samson's a Rhodes Scholar, right? Oh, yeah. He's an absolute genius. He's like an American Christian. He's got discernment. What does he do next? Oh, he goes and finds him Delilah. Delilah was working 10 poles. Jewelry. Guess what happened to him? His dad said, son, can't you find one of these godly women? Good gal? Can't you find him? There wasn't any poles in Israel, so he had to go over the other county to get one. Yeah, guess what happened? Yeah, they gouged his eyes out. They propped him up in the temple, made a complete fool out of him, laughing at him. They had him in the mill working like a minimum wage laborer. What happened there? Once you start thinking that you got that and you didn't get it from God, you're starting to get a little fuzzy, a little proud of yourself, a little bit of ego. That's coming from the demons. They're propping you up. They're telling you you're doing a great job. They say to you, oh man, you're impressive. You're a good preacher. You can teach like crazy. Oh, you got a great anointing. You're really special. You're something special. As soon as you hear that, doomsday's right around the corner. If you buy it, you buy that, you're in a short fuse. Samson bought it. He thought he was invincible. Who wouldn't? The Holy Ghost came upon him. What kind of feats did he perform? Unbelievable feats of strength and power. The Philistines were petrified of him. Petrified of him. You know what? If you'd repent tonight, turn your life over to the Lord, get those crappy little things out of your life, the exact same thing had happened to the kingdom of darkness. They'd see you coming and go, oh boy, there he is, there she is. We're in trouble now. Samson thought he was doing it on his own. I've never had my guys gouged out, but I'm guessing, medically, that doesn't feel good. The devil made a mockery of him. But what happened? What happened? Even though he was disappointed that he had failed and heartbroken, God still had mercy on him. They propped him between the pillars. His hair started to grow back. The anointing came on him. Boom. Down went the temple. Hey, if you'll rid yourself of these disappointments and stop blaming God for your problems, you're going to get an anointing fast. Come right on you. Oh boy, here's a good guy. Rich people. Mark chapter 10. When Jesus was gone in the way, there came someone running, kneeling to him. That's what Mary did. Notice that? Mary fell at his feet. Mary was not like Samson and Cain. She didn't have a huge ego. Okay? God can work with people who don't have huge egos. He can trust them with his gifts. People with tempers and who are arrogant, they don't get any gifts. You know why? You can't trust them. They'll Samson him. They think it's them. This guy was just like Mary. He fell down on his knees. He was very sincere. He was a good person. He asked the Lord, good master, didaskalos is the Greek word for teacher. He said, good teacher, what shall I do that I might inherit eternal life? And Jesus answered him and told him what it was. And he went down this list of stuff from the law. Click, 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 click. And he said, master, teacher, all these things I did from when I was little. I've done those things forever. What's going on here? Something was eating this guy's craw. He already had everything. Okay? There were very few rich people back in the day. And he was one of them. But something was bothering him. You know what it was? It was his conscience. The Spirit of the Lord was gently talking to him, saying, hey, you're lacking something. I love you. I want you to be in heaven, but there's something you're lacking. He could feel it here. He knew there was something wrong. Didn't know what it was. He did the right thing the whole time. He ran to see Jesus. He went to the correct source to get the information. The guy did everything right. He came in hopeful, believing, trusting. Oh, this guy was fantastic. Everything. I'd done all those things since I was little. And the Bible says Jesus was beholding him. Now, the Greek word is emblepo. Blepo is to see something. Okay? You're wearing a hat and glasses on your hat. Flip-flops, t-shirt, tube top, blepo. I'm looking, I'm seeing things, right? I have eyes, I can see. That's the general word for seeing, correct? This word is different. Emblepo means to look at a person. You know, looking right at them. Like I would in a counseling session. I'm just looking at you now. You got blonde hair, I think. If you came into counseling to see me, I would be looking at you, staring at you hard, looking at you. Why? I want to know what kind of person she is. I'm going to invest some of my time to help her. So I'm going to look as best I can into her soul. That's emblepo. Jesus was looking right into this guy's soul. You know what he saw in there? Sincerity, integrity, a good person. He didn't see Cain in there. He didn't see Samson in there. This guy had what we call character. He was legitimately asking God, what do I have to do to get to eternity? Because something was eating at him. Something eats at you. Let me tell you something. If you got a conscience that works and there's something eating at you, gently telling you, still small voice, gently telling you, hey, stop doing that. Get away from that person. Don't go in that building. Don't marry that man. Don't look at that girl. Don't. If you get that little thing inside there, Steve, right? You get that little thing in there, that's the biggest blessing you can ever get. It's an internal warning system of love telling you, hey, stay out of there. You're going to get caught. Okay? Samson couldn't hear that voice. He was too consumed with his own mighty power. Cain couldn't hear that voice. Too angry. Anger causes that voice to, it's gone. Brokenness revives it like stereo. Pride causes it to, gone. Gone. This guy was not like Samson or Cain. He was a good person. He had character. And Jesus looked into him and looked through him and saw that in his soul. It says he what? He loved him. He said, one thing you lack. How did he say it? It doesn't say, but I believe it was said gently. That's my interpretation. Maybe yours is different. I think Jesus gently said to him, after looking in there, he saw integrity in there, some character, some honesty. He gently said to him, you're lacking one thing. You lack something. Now, what this guy's been thinking for months, it's been eating at him. I'm missing something. What am I missing? I need to get to somebody who can tell me. He'd been to other rabbis. He was unsatisfied with their response. He got to the rabbi. Now he knew he could get an answer. See, the integrity drew him to the integrity. Con artists are drawing the people they can dominate and use and manipulate. People with sincere hearts and a broken spirit come to Christ naturally, gently, because they know he'll help them. He looked at him, loved him, and said, Hustareo, you have fallen short in one area. See, you crossed the finish line in that area. Thou shalt not commit adultery. He didn't commit adultery. That was a miracle because he was a young man. See, young men have what we call hormonal issues. As they get older, that urge tends to go down a bit. Young people tend to party more than 70-year-olds. There are exceptions. But he was a young man and he refrained himself from the sin of the day. Notice that? And he was not committing adultery. He was not stealing. He didn't have to steal. He had inherited all kinds of money, right? He did not get it. He went down the list and he said, I've done all those things from the time I was little. I'm good. You mean I lack something? Oh, well, thank God I came here today. I'm going to get an answer to this thing that's been itching in there. Something's wrong. A little warning going off. Beep, 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 beep. Something's wrong with you. Something needs to be fixed. You think you're going to heaven. You're not. You think you're in line for a great anointing. Oh, something's blocking it. You fell short in what area? What area is that, Lord? The Greek word echo means to have something in your grasp, to have control of it. You've got it. I got it. Right? Echo. Got it. Not something that's falling out. Something you, bingo, got it. He said, go sell whatever you have. You possess these things. They're yours. I got them. These are my things. I got the house. I got the furniture. I got the field. I got all the business. I've got them. They're mine. Go sell it. and give it to the poor. And you won't just have in your possession all these material things on the earth. You'll go way above and beyond that. Son, you will have treasures in glory, which put material things down here to a pathetic shame.
Amen.
Bill Gates's house in Washington looks like a trash dump compared to your condo in the New Jerusalem. His house looks like someplace they dump trash in compared to what you already have reserved for you in glory. That's what Jesus said to him. Listen, you got all these fancy material things, Mr. Gates. Listen, go sell them all and give it to the poor and come follow me, and you will have so much more than you ever gave up. It's not even funny. You will have exceedingly abundantly above all you could ever think or ask in the glory world. That's what he told him. Then he says something that killed him. He said, take up your cross and follow me. Yeah, it's the Greek word iro. That verse is chronically misinterpreted. Here's the real interpretation. Iro means to pick up and carry out of the way and get rid of it. It doesn't mean to haul a bunch of sick relatives and all this crap in your life while you're serving God. Oh, that's my cross to bear. Oh boy. That's a misinterpretation of the scripture. That's a false doctrine. You're to get rid of those things and then go follow. That should have landed. You see, in our society here in America, as soon as you get saved, you're an evangelist now. Yeah. Go on out on the street and start praying for the street people. You go out there, you'll be picking up demons left and right. See, you're to get rid of your cross before you follow him. Listen, I just read it. It says, come, get rid of the cross. What was his cross? He had put his love and affection on material things and money because he had inherited a huge estate from his family. He was rich. He had lived the American dream. That's all we ever talk about here, is making it big. That's all they do in Hollywood, going out to make it big. No, the cross was his affection for the things of this world. And Jesus told him, get rid of that. Come follow me, and I'll replace that 1,000 times more in glory when you're done following me. You got a condo in the New Jerusalem. You got so much wealth and so much glory there. It's ridiculous. And what happened? Oh, the devil got him again. The island of disappointments. He floated right over there and got off the boat. The guy was crushed. And he was a good person. This isn't Cain or Samson, two certified idiots. This was a good person with integrity and character. This person actually loved God. Are you listening to me? This person loved God. He was not a filthy, nasty sinner. But he had this little idol set up in there, in his soul. Creature comforts, luxuries, money, status, cash, success in America. Oh my God. It's suicidal if you're not a success. Everybody looks like you crawled out from under a rock. Success is a horrible evil. Unless it's the Holy Ghost you're successful with. Oh, then you've got treasures you can't even count. You'll never count them. He was a good person. He loved God. God loved him. But he lacked. You've fallen short in one area. There's a little temple of greed in there. You like these material things too much. Tell you what, get rid of them and come follow me. And I'll replace them a thousandfold or whatever. How did he react to that? He became disappointed. Why? Katema, he had a huge estate. Which leads me to believe, and I can't prove it, but I think this is true. He was probably the firstborn, because the firstborn got the bigger chunk of the estate in Jewish society. And his parents were wealthy. He had inherited everything. He was used to it. He was raised in luxury. You know, if you're raised a certain way, it's hard to adopt another system, right? That just happened on a TV show, didn't it? The Bachelorette. She took one of the bachelors home, and the parents looked at him and go, "This guy's a total loser. What do you do for a living?" He goes, "I'm a songwriter." Okay, a songwriter is going to marry my daughter? They was none too happy. Hey, he was raised in luxury. But unlike the other young men, he didn't let it go to his head. He continued to serve God. He didn't live in sin. He had character and integrity. And he came to Jesus with an honest and good heart. And he had all those assets and found out he had fallen short in one area. Samson and Cain would have never known that, because they never looked inside and saw themselves. He did. He did. He knew there was something wrong with me. I got to fix this thing. Fix it. And then he leaves disappointed. Every person here tonight has a series of disappointments. Every single person here. I know that. And some of those disappointments are still bothering. This week, a woman sends an email to Kelly, and this person is looking for a job, and they explain to Kelly how angry they are at God because they've had all these disappointments. She's had all these disappointments in her life. She was explaining it in the email to Kelly. The next day, God answered her prayer, and she got the job. She got a job. She sends Kelly an email. Praise Jesus. Then she goes on to say, "I hope God does this and that and this and that." This woman was praising Jesus and hated God. That's a new one for you. After I read those emails, I said to myself, I now know why. I've never been able to get one demon out of this woman. Why did she hate God? Chronic disappointments. The devil kept telling her, "Hey, it's God's fault. He won't answer your prayer. He's not going to help you. And she developed anger, bitterness toward him. And the only time she ever praises Jesus is when he does something for her. If something bad happens, she goes back to giving it to the good Lord. Now, you've gotten over a lot of your disappointments tonight. Turn off the lights there. You've gotten over a lot of your disappointments, but there's a couple left stuck in your craw. A regret. Bitterness toward God. He disappointed you. You handle it differently. You got mad. You got depressed. You got self-pity. You all handle everything differently. Each person's an individual. But the bottom line is, carrying a disappointment will destroy your spiritual life. Because all your disappointments are designed by God to lead you to victories. Well, it hasn't happened to me. It's been years. It'll be a lot more years until you change your attitude toward God about all these basic things: money, relationships, health, jobs. All these things we're all involved in all the time, and we pray and ask for help, the basics of life, and those disappointments start adding up, and it starts to block your blessings. That woman I just told you about will never see her life restored. I've talked to her 4 different times about repenting of being angry at God. 4 times. I don't know what else to do. She will never be restored, because the demons told her it was God's fault. He did it. He let you down, Mary. He let you down, Martha. He didn't show up. Then the devil quoted the Bible to you. Oh, God will supply all your needs. He's lying. Oh, you just lay your hands on the sick and you immediately recover. He's lying. Oh, you just, every person who believes can cast out demons. Oh, and they're not coming out, are they? Oh, God's lying. The devil will tell you God doesn't follow his word. He will tell you that God's a liar. And the second you believe it, click, that stops it right there. You're in deep trouble. Let's pray together. Father God, I took these examples from your word, Lord, tonight to expose the devil on what he does with people when they have disappointments, and we all have them. I've had uncountable numbers of disappointments over the years. So has everybody else. Father God, there's some people here tonight who went with Cain and they got angry. They got angry at you. There's some people here tonight, they're Marthas and they're Marys, and they're disappointed at you, Lord. They're disappointed because you should have showed up earlier. You should have done this and you should have done that. They're blaming you, Father, when it was the devil the whole time doing it. You would never hurt anybody. You would never abandon anybody. Father, I pray tonight for my friends here that the islands of disappointments, that they will leave there tonight. They will get on the rescue ship and leave. Disappointed relationships, money, career, friends, relatives, parents, children, disobedient children. I pray, Lord, right now, for each person here that still has one or two disappointments they've been carrying over, getting fired on a job, getting a divorce, an ex, a death of a child, a bankruptcy, a foreclosure, whatever it is, you're still carrying that disappointment in your soul, and it's hurting you spiritually. You're disappointed that God hasn't used you more than he has in the past. You're disappointed you're not completely delivered from demons yet. The devil's starting to tell you that God's at fault. Listen, it happens to everybody. Everything I've just talked to you about has happened to me. We're all in this together. But you're going to repent tonight, aren't you? You got a couple disappointments. The other ones you've already bagged, they don't bother you anymore. They're gone. They happened years ago. But you've still got a couple left. And it's those couple of disappointments that are hurting you spiritually right now. They're hurting you. So will you raise your hand so I can pray for you? If you got a couple disappointments left, could be family, could be business, could be a bankruptcy, anything. Thank you for that. There you go. Good. Any over here? There's one. Another one. Over here. Thank you, Jesus. There you go. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, now I'm not going to ask you to come down the front. Just stand up where you are. We raise your hand. Just stand up in front of your chair there. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You see these people standing up right there, Lord? They raise their hands. They raise their hands, and they're to be healed tonight. They are to be healed tonight. And this disappointment in their soul, this sense of loss, the sense of failure, the sense that you have abandoned them, is going to leave tonight. This deep-seated sense of regret and loss, and you look back on it and you think, oh Lord, why didn't you just let me do this? Why couldn't I have had that? Why didn't this happen? Why didn't that happen? You go through that why thing. And at the end of it, it always hurts you more when you go through whys. And you're going to repent of it right now. You're not going to hold back. You're going to let your tears go. The Holy Ghost is here. Father God, I ask you right now to touch my friends, the ones that are standing. They have a couple of disappointments left. A couple left. And they're going to repent of it right now. And I'll help you. Dear Jesus, I'm so sorry I've carried this with me for so many years. I'm so sorry I saw you as a problem instead of my asset. I'm so sorry, Lord, that I carried these regrets around with me. I was so disappointed that I should have done this, but I did that, and it's haunted me ever since. I had a chance to marry this person. I married that one. It was the wrong one. I am so sorry I've carried this pain in my soul. I'm so sorry I carried this pain in my soul. Dear Lord, please forgive me. Please forgive me. In the name of Jesus, I'm going to cast this disappointment right out of my soul tonight. And just put your hands right on your chest and your stomach there. Put your hand right there, right there. Father God, in the name of Jesus, the Son of God, we take authority over this disappointment and this pain in the soul. We take authority over it. By the blood of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Ghost, and we command this disappointment to lift out of our souls right now in the name of Jesus. I command this thing to come out of me now. Come out, you rotten devil. Come out, you rotten devil. Come out, you rotten devil. Come out right now. Disappointment, come up right now, quickly. Sorrow and misery, come up right now, quickly. Come up right now. Come up right now. Hurry up. Come on up right now. Hurry. Come up right now. Come up right now. Come out right now. There it is. Come on up. Come out. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Come on out right now. Come out of there right now. There it comes. There it goes. Come on, keep going. Keep going. Come on out. Come on out. Quickly. Come out quickly. Hey, buddy. Come on out. Come out in Jesus' name. Come on, just forgive yourself right now. Forgive yourself. Come out. Take a breath and blow. Take a breath and blow. Take a breath and blow.
Up and up. Up and up.
Come out.
Go, 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 go.
Come out. I forgive myself, oh God. I forgive myself. Come out. Come out. Every disappointment. Every disappointment. Samson, come out. Samson, come out. Samson. Cain. Come out. Cain, I command you to come out. Come out. Every disappointment. Every heartache. Now. Every broken relationship. Every dollar you wasted. Every dollar you lost. Every rotten person you were with. Come out. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Come out right now. Come out right now. Every disappointment, every heartache, every sad sorrow. Come out. All the wasted years. All those wasted years. The regrets. Blaming yourself. Come out. Blaming yourself. You married a rotten man. You married a lousy woman. You blame yourself. You carry that regret. Come out in Jesus' name. Come out. Come out. Get out of there. Go in Jesus' name. Come out. Misery. Sadness. Samson. Arrogance. Samson, come out. Pride. Cain. Cain, I command you to come out. Evil. Perversion. Cain, you pervert. Come out. Right now, go. I said go. Out. Out of there. Come out. Come out. Come out. Cain, come out. Samson, come out. Get out of that body. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Witchcraft. Sorcery. Disappointments, every one of them, come out. Self-hatred, come out. Right now. Self-hatred, come out now. Go. Come out. Get out of that body. Sickness, disappointment, I haven't been healed. I haven't been healed. Come out. Every sickness, come out. Come on out of there. The divorce. The divorce. Come out. The divorce. Come out of there. The divorce. Come out right now. Hurry up. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. You married somebody who turned out to be a psycho, and your soul is wounded from it. Disappointment over your spouse. Come out! Disappointments. Spouse. Disappointment. You got rid of somebody you should have married. You should have married that person and not that person. Come on! Get out of there!
Good girl.
Come out of that body quicker. Hurry up. Come out of that body right now. Quicker. Come out of there. Terror. Fear. Terror. Fear. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Come out. Abuse. Child abuse. Sexual abuse. Come out, you pervert. Come out, you demon of fear. Come out of that body right now. Go in Jesus' mighty name. Let's go. Every disappointment. Every disappointment. Every rotten man. Every bad woman. Having kids when you shouldn't have had them. Having kids when you shouldn't have had them. You sinned in front of your children, now they're sinning. Your children are lost because of you. You're going to forgive yourself tonight. You will forgive yourself tonight. Your kids are on the road to hell because they saw you. They watched you. They imitated you. You will now forgive yourself tonight so your children can be saved. You got to forgive yourself. It's blocking your child's salvation. You forgive yourself. It's blocking your child's coming to Christ because you have aught against yourself. You are living with disappointments. I should have been a better father. I should have been a better mother. I failed my children. Now they're serving Satan. Now they're serving Satan. Oh my God. My God, it's my fault. No. You turn that over to the Lord tonight and release that sin. Release that ought against yourself. Receive your forgiveness. Receive your mercy. Do it tonight in Jesus' holy name. You'll receive your mercy tonight. Come on. Let those tears go. Let those tears go. The rich young ruler, he was a good person, but he was falling short in one area. He fell short in one area. He was a good person. Come on. Holy Spirit, I ask you to convict. Rain down conviction. Rain down conviction. Rain down conviction. Holy Ghost, fall. Holy Spirit, we give you praise tonight. Thank you, Jesus, for the Holy Ghost. Right now, in Jesus' name. Conviction, come on. Conviction. You feel guilty because you should have been a better mother. You should have been a better father. And now your kids, they live like the devil. And they live that way because of you. But tonight, you forgive yourself. You forgive yourself. You forgive yourself now. Now, so you can be healed. The curses will not come off you until you forgive yourself. Is your life cursed? We cannot get those curses off of you unless you forgive yourself. You must forgive others. You must forgive yourself. Or we cannot make off the curses. We can't do it. Come on. Just repent of it. Come on. Just repent of it. Come out now. Devil, come out now. Satan, you liar. You liar. Satan, come out. Satan, come out now. You liar. You lied to me. Come out. Out. Every demon, every disappointment, every lie, come out of that body right now. Come out of that body right now. Come out of there. Get out of that body right now. Come out quicker. Quicker. Come on out. Quicker. Come out, you stinking devil. Let her go. Let the woman of God go. Come out, Satan. Come on, fight back. Fight. Fight back. You got to fight. Come on, let's go. I repent. I repent. Over. I repent over it.
What'd you say? Can you pray for my cousin over there?
With that girl?
Yeah.
What's wrong with her? What's wrong with her?
They have been in a very messed up attitude, so we don't know what is wrong with them.
Do they want prayer?
Yeah.
Hey. Is it okay if I pray for you tonight? Is that okay with you? Come on with me. There you go. Come on up here. Wait here. Stay right there. Come on over here. There you go. Hey, my name's Mike. Mike. Hey, what's wrong with you? Something bothering you?
No.
Okay. Why did your parents want me to pray for you? Is it okay if I pray for you? Okay, close your eyes. Open your mouth. Atta girl. What's your name, sweetheart?
Ariel.
Oh, pretty. You're beautiful. You got a pretty face. Ariel's a pretty name, too. All right, close your eyes. Open your mouth. You rotten devil. I know you're in there. I command you to come out of your stomach and out of your throat. Come out right now. Every demon from her parents, every demon of verbal abuse, every spirit from her mom and dad, come out of that stomach right now. Go. Now take a breath and blow like this. Blow. Go, come out now. Keep blowing. Come out now. Come out now. Come out. Come on out. Come out of there. Come out. Come out of there. Spirit of rebellion. Spirit of anger. Come out. Come out of there right now. Come out. Come on out. Come out of there. Come out. Just repeat after me. Dear Jesus, save me.
Dear Jesus, save me.
Come into my heart, Lord.
Come into my heart, Lord.
And heal my soul.
Heal my soul.
Yes, touch me, Lord.
Huh?
Touch me, Jesus.
Touch me, Jesus.
Ready? Okay, take a big breath. Breathe.
Go. Leave this body. Get out in Jesus' name. Get out now. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out.
Did you feel anything when you were praying?
Get out, Jesus.
Nothing? Did you sense anything in your stomach moving around? What did it feel like?
I don't know.
Was it like butterflies? Was it going like that? Okay. That's a demon in there. Now just repeat after me. Spirit.
Spirit.
I command you to come out of me.
I command you to come out of me.
Right now.
Right now.
Come out. Come out. Come up. Come on out. Out. Leave her. I command you to leave at the count of three. One, two, three. Okay. Tell your brother to come down here.
Get out.
Hey, my name's Mike. How come your parents want you to get prayer tonight?
I don't know.
Are you having a problem of some kind?
No.
Are they having a problem with you?
Yeah.
What is it?
Being bad.
Being bad? Do you want to be bad?
No.
Okay. Now listen, your family, whole family needs prayer. Okay. And I'm going to pray for you, and you tell me if you sense anything in your stomach or your chest, okay? All right. Ready? Ready? Anything? Anything up here? What's your name?
AJ.
AJ, okay. Lord Jesus, I ask you to bless AJ tonight. I ask you to touch his heart. I ask you to take this rebellion demon and anger demon out of him. I bind that spirit. I bind that ugly spirit of anger and rebellion. And I command you to stop. Let your hands off this boy. Release him. Heal. Now tell you, is that your mom over there?
Correct.
Over there.
That's your grandma.
Grandma? Now tell her to come over here, will you?
You no longer remain in my body. Get out in Jesus' name. Get out in the name of Jesus. I command you, get out. No longer do you remain in my being. Any longer, get out. You are loosed. I no longer accept.
Hey, you grandma?
Yeah.
What's your name? What?
Eleanor.
Eleanor.
Jesus' name. Get out.
I forgot my cane.
Eleanor.
Yeah.
Both them grandkids are loaded with demons.
I know AJ is really bad.
Yeah. Hers were moving around her stomach.
Huh?
Hers were moving around her stomach.
Oh, wow.
Okay? But, their parents probably are as well. Who's the dad?
He's right there. He's my only son. Their mom, I adopted them. The mom did drugs when she was pregnant from him.
Okay.
And
now,
he stopped doing drugs, and she's still on drugs.
What's your name?
My name's Eleanor.
Eleanor. Now, Eleanor,
yes.
You are a very caring person. And when you love somebody, you love them.
Yes.
No matter what. Okay? And the devil has a special program for people like you. He teaches them to love too much and to carry burdens for the people. And you're carrying burdens for not only those two, but the rest of them. The whole family's messed up. Okay? And the first person that has to get healed tonight is you.
I'm a Christian.
I know you are. Now, you're also a loving person. Okay? Now, these bad men that you've had in the past, the verbal abusers, that stuff, okay? Just close your eyes, breathe out of your mouth.
I live by myself. I'm not involved with no man.
I'm talking about way in your past. Yeah. How old are you?
60 almost.
Yeah, ready? Yeah. Close your eyes. Father, I got Eleanor here, and she's hurting really bad in her soul, right in there. And the devil's got her carrying burdens for her family. Now she's carrying her grandchildren, in addition to her children. And the devil is tricking her. The Bible says we are to cast all our care upon you, for you care for us. And she's not doing that. In addition, instead of using the Holy Spirit as a comfort, she's using food. And the devil is trying to give her all kinds of diseases. Heart conditions, high blood pressure, diabetes, the whole deal. He wants her to have all of these ugly, evil blessings from him. And in addition, in her past, she has been abused by bad men. They have dishonored and disrespected her. And her soul is tired. She's tired. And her body is wearing out. Her body is wearing out. And she's going to be gone before she's able to ever help her grandchildren. And you are not, you do not want that to happen to her. Because you love her and you care about her. Now, Father God, I want you to go back right now, even into childhood. Every spirit she picked up as a child through abuse and disappointments. Every spirit in that body that craves food. Every unclean spirit of food. We bind your power right now. We command this ugly demon of disappointment and exhaustion and the spirit of infirmity wearing out her body. We command you in the name of Jesus to be bound and to come up. Come on up. Come on, let's go. Come out of her stomach quickly. I know you're in there. Come out right now. Come out. You're torturing her. You're tormenting her. I know you're doing it. Every ugly transfer spirit from a bad man from years ago, every one of them, I command you to come out in the name of Jesus. Lord, forgive me for holding on to burdens. Forgive me for carrying burdens when I should have turned them over to you. Forgive me for using food as a comfort. I repent of it right this second. I repent right now. I'm sorry I hurt you, Lord. I'm asking you for forgiveness. I'm asking you to break off the curses of my children and my grandchildren. The demonic curses, I've fallen on them now. And I want them free. So I'm going to turn them over to you now. In the name of Jesus. And I command every unclean spirit in my body, giving me a sickness, giving me obesity, attacking my heart, trying to give me diabetes, all of them. I command these spirits to come out now. Get out of my body right now. Come out now. Come out of there. Come out, I said. Come out now. You filthy, unclean spirit. Come out of me right now. You spirit of death. Come out of me right now. Right now, get out of there. You're trying to kill me. I know what you're doing. Come out right now. Come on out. Come on out. You speak in tongues. So just pray after me. Roba Shata. Kelo Sati. Neno Masha. Pandoria. Vakamu. Can you notice how easy you repeat that? But this time just repeat after me and then you add some syllables on your own, then it will just start taking off.
Like okay? English?
No, you follow me and then you add syllables. Not words, but syllables like I'm doing.
Well, it's syllables.
Syllables are like California is four syllables. California. Kalo Masha. That's tongues. That's four syllables. Notice that?
I don't know. I never understood that.
Did you hear me?
I never understood that, how to do that to become tongues.
No, you don't have to understand it. It'll just start coming out on its own. Okay? Just repeat after me, then use some other syllables on your own. Let's try it again. Ready? Kola Shata. Velo Mashamasi. Vosha Bata. Dendoro Moshanda. Kola Shanda. Kola Vasheve. Kora Mashandai. Yekolava. Kondara Mashandi. Kelo Masi. Vora Vashanda. I command you, evil spirit, come out of me now. Come out right now. Hurry. Come out of my lungs right now. Quick. Come out. Come out of my lungs. Out now. Do you sense anything in there when you were praying that prayer?
No, I don't feel nothing.
Huh?
No.
You don't feel anything?
Well, she prayed for me last time.
Did you feel nothing? Okay, something's blocking it. Do you have any bad feelings about anybody you can think of? Bad emotions about another person?
No, just I'm sad because two of my daughters, they don't respect me as their mother.
Right.
Really about that. And I decided to be with the ones who love me, my little grandkids.
Right. You sense they don't love you anymore?
Yeah.
Okay, what's their names?
Priscilla and Angelica.
Okay, you ready? Just breathe out of your mouth. Breathe out of your mouth. Priscilla and Angelica, in the name of Jesus, we choose to forgive you tonight. We choose to have mercy on your souls. And we are praying for you, just like the Bible says, love your enemies, bless those who curse you.
Amen.
Pray for those who despitefully use you.
Amen.
And I repent of carrying this wound in my soul about my two daughters. And I release it from my soul right now. They don't love me, and that hurt me. They disrespect me as their mother, and that hurt my soul. And I want to release them both into your hands, Lord, right now. In the name of Jesus. Come out of me now. Okay, take a big breath and blow. Blow. Good. Blow again. Come out. Both sisters, daughters, come out right now. Come on out. Come out of there. Ot. Soul wounds. Come out in Jesus' name. Come on out. Come out right now. I let my daughters go. I release them from my soul right now. Blow. Come out and release. And release. Which knee is hurting you?
Well, they're both going bad because I'm heavy.
They're both going bad?
Yeah.
Do you have pain in both of them?
Sometimes I lose my balance too.
Did you have them tonight? Pain?
Huh?
Do you have pain tonight? Do you have pain in your knees tonight?
Earlier I did, not tonight.
Oh, which knee?
This one.
Oh, that one. Is there any pain in it now if you go stretch it out? Does that hurt? Just try that one. Does that hurt?
Not that much.
Just a little bit? Less than that one?
This one, yeah.
Okay. Father God, I ask you to take these two daughters out of her soul right now and remove them from her and this sorrow she has in her soul. In Jesus' name, I let them go now. At the count of three. One, two, three. Go!
What am I supposed to do?
And I ask you, Lord, to heal these knees right now in the name of Jesus. Give her power and strength.
I need to just wait because I gained so much weight with diabetic medication.
Right now, Lord, diabetes is caused by soul wounds. The person, did you used to hate yourself when you were young?
No.
Have you ever seen yourself as a disgusting?
No.
Have you ever hated your body?
No.
Okay. Have you ever hated anybody?
Did I hate anybody?
Yeah, your life.
Well, the guys who, my uncle who molested me when I was 5 years old.
You were five? What was his name?
Roy.
What did he do to you?
Well, he touched me in my private...
In your vagina?
Yes.
He rubbed you down there? Did he make you do anything to him?
I don't remember. I just know that hurt me.
His name was Roy?
Roy, and I told my mom and she didn't do anything about it.
Oh, your mother betrayed you?
Well, because she had to work and she left me with my grandma to babysit.
And that's when he got you?
Yeah.
How many times that happened?
I don't know, I was little. Then my stepfather molested me too.
Your stepdad did? What's his name?
He's passed on.
Was it fondling or intercourse?
No, just fondling.
Same thing down your vagina?
With the fingers, yeah.
How many times did that happen?
Oh my gosh, I don't even know. I was little. I was like 8 years old.
More than once?
Yeah.
And when you were five, did it happen more than once?
Yes, with my uncle and then my stepdad.
And your stepdad did it too?
Yeah.
Fondling?
And before he died, he asked me to forgive him.
What was your age then?
8 years old.
No,
my uncle was when I was five years old, and my dad's stepdad was eight.
And the other one was 11.
Huh?
What was the third one? Was 11, right?
No, I didn't. No, not 11.
Oh, there's only two?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Father God, a spirit entered her body when she was 5 years old. When he molested her, he had demons.
Yes.
And when the demons told him to come at her, and he was rubbing her, and he hurt her.
Yes. Yes.
And a spirit of fear entered in that day.
Yes.
Roy, in the name of Jesus, you come out of there tonight. Come on out. We forgive him and we release him from her soul right now.
Amen.
Okay, take a breath and blow. Roy, come out of there right now. Go. Come on out. Go. Come on out. Spirit of rejection, come out. Spirit of lust, come out. Spirit of perversion, come out. Get out of there right now. Go. I forgive both my molesters right now. I forgive them. I forgive them. And I release them from my soul right now. Go. Go now. And heal. Check out your knees now. Stand up. Any change?
Still hurts.
They're still hurting? Okay, sit down.
I feel shaky.
Okay.
Can I have some water?
Yeah.
My water's a little bit bad.
Is that her water, your grandma? This one is? Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, something's blocking this deliverance. Do you have any idea what it is?
No. I don't know. I'm used to carrying my... I'm a mother, father, grandpa, grandma, rolled up in one. I don't know. Maybe...
Okay.
I'm so strong, when, helping my family, maybe that's why. I don't know.
When did you first get saved?
Oh my God, I don't know, years ago.
And
I was baptized some Christian church with me. My
were you
mom.
Ever born again?
Yes.
When did that happen?
That time.
At that time?
Yes.
How'd you know you were born again? You sensed something?
They told me, and I accepted God in my heart and all that.
Did you ever have any spiritual sense you were born again?
I don't know what you mean by that.
Have you ever had any experience with the Holy Spirit at all?
I felt like something come inside, you know, warm.
Warmth? When was that?
Scary.
When did that happen?
When I go to church.
Oh, what church you go to?
I don't know the name, Family United on Buckeye.
Is it a Protestant or a Catholic?
It's a Christian church.
Christian church?
Yes.
Okay.
Is that Pentecostal?
Do you remember that last time, the last time you felt that warmth? Do you remember that last time in your mind?
Yeah,
you do?
Yeah.
Okay, ready? Now go back there right now. Go back to that spot you were at. There it is. Go back there right now. Holy Spirit, come in again. Holy Spirit, touch her again, just like you did back then. Touch her, Lord. Touch her, dear Lord. Touch her, dear Lord. Touch your dear Lord. Okay, take a big breath. Come in. Breathe again. Holy Spirit, come in. Holy Spirit, come in. Anything? Any warmth?
I feel peace.
Did you go back where you were when you first felt that warmth in your mind? Did you sense anything then?
I just feel like peace.
Okay.
I don't know what I'm supposed to feel. I don't know.
You said you felt warmth the last time, remember?
Yes. Uh-huh.
And you didn't feel that this time?
It was peaceful.
Did you have the peace last time too?
Mm-hmm.
Did you have the warmth?
Yes.
Okay. Now just raise your hands for a second. Dear Jesus, I love you. I love you, dear Lord. I give you praise.
Glorify your name.
Thank you, Jesus. Please take this ugly disease out of my body. Please remove this pain in my knees. Please remove this spirit of food that's causing me to eat too much. In the name of Jesus, come out of that body right now. Right now, go. Come out, devil. Do you have any demons in there?
I don't think so. They always pray for me and anoint me at church. I don't know.
Okay,
he would have said something, I think.
Who would have?
The pastor.
Well, do they do any deliverance over there? Oh, they do? They never.
They break bread on the. You know,
I mean, do they try to cast demons out of people over at that
yeah.
church? Okay.
They pray for
no one ever tried to help you?
Yeah, they prayed for me lots of times.
Well, I mean, did they ever try to cast demons out of you
they didn't
over
say
at that
had,
church?
No, they didn't say I had demons for me. They
okay.
just prayed for me.
Oh, okay. Now, what in your mind, what would be causing all these problems? The diabetes, the obesity, the pain?
Well, my it runs in my family diabetic. We're a lot of obese in our family. My knees, because I'm overweight. I think that's why my knees are going back, and I'm way overweight.
Do you live near here?
Yeah.
Oh, you do? Could you come in for a private counseling session?
No, I never came.
Huh?
Can
you come in?
Yeah.
Can you come? Okay. When you go out, will you go to a bookstore and get one of my cards from
okay.
Lori and then give me a call tonight?
Okay.
And
yeah,
I'll put you.
I even buy anointing oil here last time.
Oh, you did? Okay.
But right now, that's why. Let's go back to the church and get some more oil and,
okay.
and check out the church. You know?
Okay. Get one of my cards when you, and come call me tonight and I'll put you on the schedule, okay? And we'll get to the bottom of this.
Okay.
All right. Thank you for coming in. Bless you.
Hi. We match, Mike. Pink.
Is that pink? It's
yeah.
red. Hey, what's going on here?
So she is suffering from can you kind of explain it?
So this
woman is she's an attorney.
Who's an attorney?
She is.
Yeah. And what's wrong with her?
She's brilliant. Sydney
what's wrong
is
with
my She's got spirits of mental illness, and specifically the one that we're here for today is a destructive one. She's beating her head on the wall. She's biting.
What's the diagnosis?
There is none.
She hasn't been to a psychiatrist or
psychologist? Yes, she's been to 20 different doctors, including
okay,
psychiatrists and psychologists, and nobody will give her a diagnosis. But she gets better for a while. And then she comes under it again.
Increasingly harmful to herself.
Yeah.
She disassociates. She starts she'll just check out. I went soft to her. It was everything was clicking. It was making sense. She was smiling. She was
here now.
Just a second ago.
Who's here now?
What's that?
Is that her?
No.
That's the other one.
Yeah.
What's her name?
Sydney.
Hey, Sydney. Hey. Come here, sweetheart. Stand up. Hey, I'm the counselor here. Stop crying. Sydney, honey, look at me. Stop crying, sweetheart. Hey, I want to talk to you about something.
Okay.
You're a very loved person by God. He likes you. Okay. But Sydney, listen to me. Look at me. Demons are putting negative thoughts in your mind, and you're receiving them. And that's why you're crying right now. You hear me? Can you hear me? Sydney? Okay. Now just pray after me, okay? Dear Jesus. Pray after me, honey. Come on. You can do it.
You gotta say the words after.
Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Please forgive me.
Please forgive me.
For listening to demons.
For listening to demons.
Put negative thoughts in my mind.
Put negative thoughts in my mind.
Giving me fear and sorrow.
Giving me fear and sorrow.
Terror, misery.
Terror, misery.
It's not me.
It's not me.
There's nothing wrong with me.
There's nothing wrong with me.
It's them. It's them. There's nothing wrong with me.
It's them.
It's them. And tonight I want these spirits out of me. I want those spirits out of me. Sydney, come on.
I want these spirits out of me.
All right, now why are you crying?
I'm crying because I think I said something or did something or made some phone calls or something, and
mm-hmm.
then the police came and my mom betrayed me to the police.
Okay.
And then it kept happening.
Yeah,
and it
Sydney.
Keeps happening.
Hey, Sydney, look at me.
Yeah.
Those thoughts that you're thinking right there, you just vocalized them.
Yeah.
Those, they're not your thoughts.
Okay.
It's a spirit putting them in there. It's not you. There's nothing wrong with you. There's nothing wrong with you. It's all a trick. Sydney, there's nothing wrong with you. No, it's not thanks. I'm telling you a fact. There's nothing wrong with you. God loves you dearly. You're a beautiful woman. You're very intelligent. It's all lies. You're listening to lies all day. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Now, what are you thinking now?
I'm thinking that I should believe you, but I'm trying to put my heart into it.
I'm telling the truth. Here's how you can know. Those thoughts you're having, you don't want.
Right.
So they're not yours. If they're negative thoughts, they're not from God.
Right.
That means they're from demons.
Yeah.
It's not you. There's nothing wrong with you. You don't want the thoughts. They can't come from God because he never uses negative thoughts to help people, right? So there's only one person left. Now, what are you thinking about now?
I'm having trouble remembering what you just said.
No, you remembered it.
Okay.
Didn't you?
Right.
It's not you.
It's not me. The thoughts are...
The thoughts are from them.
And not from God, and that's not me.
Right. There's nothing wrong with you.
Yeah.
It's all a trick.
Exactly.
The demons are trying to steal your mind because they want you to be their slave. They're lying.
Yeah, exactly.
Are you a Christian?
Yeah, I'm a Christian.
Do you speak in tongues?
Not except languages, I think.
Pardon me?
Not unless... No, I speak some foreign languages, but I don't...
Oh, okay. No, I mean the prayer language. The prayer language.
No.
Okay.
That would be a good idea.
Come on, back away from...
Listen. Hey, what are you crying for now? What thought do you have in your head?
I guess...
What thought you just have?
I don't know what thought it was.
Okay.
I guess.
It wasn't your thought, right?
Right. It wasn't my thought.
It wasn't God.
It wasn't God.
It was them.
It was them.
Okay.
Now,
put your hand on your head.
Okay.
Like that. And breathe out of your mouth. Breathe out of your mouth. Now you just pray. I'm going to pretend I'm you. And I'm going to pray. And you pray in your head. And keep blowing out of your mouth. Pray in your head.
Okay.
Dear Lord Jesus, keep blowing. I am so sorry that I hurt you by listening to demons. You love me and you want me to listen to you, not them. But I sit around all day listening to demons. And I apologize. I apologize. And from this day forward, I'm not going to listen to negative thoughts in my mind or listen to demons anymore. I'm quitting it right now because that's a sin. And you love me and I love you. And I command this evil spirit in my head. He's a liar. He was sent to me by the devil, and I renounce him. I command him.
I command him.
In the name of Jesus Christ,
by
his blood, to come out of my body right now. Get out of my head. Keep blowing. Come on, spirit. Let's go. Come out of her right now. She told you to go. Come on out. Come out. You know you're lying to her. You know she's not sick. It's not her. She's not mentally ill. You're lying. Come out. Get out of my head. Come out. Right now. I command you to get out of my brain right this second. Come out now.
I command you to get out of my brain right this second.
Now go.
Now go.
Good girl. Blow. Come out. Come out, you devil. Come out of it. Come on out of there.
Come out.
In the name of Jesus, be healed. Feel that? It popped out of your head. Thank you, Jesus. Go on. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I'm not sick. I love you. Thank you for healing me. Thank you, dear Lord. I am not sick. It's all lies. Years of lies. You wasted years. There's nothing wrong with you. You're a beautiful woman. You're intelligent. There's nothing wrong with you. They were doing it. They're doing it. Here, for example, hey,
well, yeah,
just for fun, I'll prove it to you. Whenever I pray with someone up here at the altar alone,
yeah,
a Martian always shows up by that window and looks.
Okay.
Did you hear me?
Yeah.
Did you believe me? Did you believe that a Martian shows up over there? You believe that? You don't believe that because you were laughing.
Yeah.
Okay, that lie I just told you, I just made it up.
Yeah.
Right now, I made it up.
Yeah.
That's as stupid as what they told you. They just made it up.
Okay, yeah.
Do you understand?
Yeah.
It's all made up. What's the most frequent thing they say? Like right now, what are they saying?
That things have happened over and over again, and they just happen a little bit differently, but it's the same thing. And and like you should hit your head, or you've done stuff that
they're
like,
making it up.
Yeah, like people are chasing you, and you're
why are you
to
listening to them?
Or something.
Why are you listening?
I don't know. It's not a. It doesn't make sense.
You didn't listen to me when I said that. You start laughing.
Yeah.
That's that statement stupid. There are no Martians. They don't exist. You're listening to them talk to you. It's fake. It's not real.
Right.
Nothing they said is real. There's nothing wrong with you.
Yeah, exactly.
Are you listening to me?
I am listening.
There's nothing wrong with you.
Okay.
They were putting negative thoughts in your head. You were over there screaming. You were on the ground over there screaming.
Yeah, yeah.
Can you believe that? If they told you to paint your face green and run out in traffic, would you go do it? Would you do it? Paint your face green. Go on. Would you do it?
No.
Well, then why were you doing that?
Because
you were listening to them.
Okay, yeah.
It's all fake.
Yeah.
That's their job. They lie all the time. Everything they say, the opposite's true.
Okay.
They always lie. That's their job.
Yeah.
But you've been listening to them. That's why you're sick. She said you went to 20 psychologists. There was no need to go there. They can't help you. They don't understand what's wrong with you. I just told you what's wrong with you.
Yeah.
You're listening to voices, thoughts in your mind that are not yours.
Yeah.
And they're fake. They're just made up.
Yeah.
Go cut yourself. They just made it up. But if you do it, then they'll keep saying it. Correct? If you listen to them, they'll keep saying the same thing over and over. Understand?
Yeah.
Okay. Now we're going to pray with you right now.
Okay.
Close your eyes there.
Close your eyes,
girl. All right. Ready? Raise your hands. Thank you, Jesus. What was your name again? Sydney?
Huh?
What's your name?
Sydney.
What'd she say?
Sydney.
Yeah, Sydney. That's what I thought. Okay. What thoughts did you just have? Sydney, come back. What thought was that?
My thought was that my parents have tortured.
Why did you listen to that thought? They just made it up. Why'd you do that? Okay? In the name of Jesus, I command that thought to leave me now. What's that thought? You just had a thought. What was it?
The thought was that I said a bunch of angry things that gave the reason to like bring cops and things into it, and then I went mentally ill right after that.
Okay, you're not mentally ill. That's a lie. And what you just said was another lie. It's not real. Go ahead and repent of it. Dear Jesus, forgive me for saying something that wasn't true. And that's a lie. Forgive me for listening to demons. Talk to me in my head. Please forgive me. Now I want these spirits out of my... What's that thought right there?
That was me imagining screaming in the other room.
Okay, go ahead and repent of it. You're not to listen to demons anymore. Go on. I repent of screaming in the living room. Go on. Come on. Repent of it. What's that thought right there? Hey, what's Sydney? What's that thought? Sydney, what's that thought?
It's the thought that I deceived myself into going crazy so that I could get out of crime or sin or something or some trouble, and then I didn't trust my mom. And
Sydney, that all of that is all gobbledygook. It's all made up. It's not true. Now just repent of it. Dear Jesus, I repent of listening to insane thoughts. Have mercy on me, Lord.
Have mercy on me.
Thank you for loving me. What's that thought right there? What was that thought? Sydney, what's that thought?
I don't really know. I don't know.
What are you thinking right now? Tell me. Sydney.
I think I'm thinking that I manipulated all my memories.
Okay. Are you going to repent of that? It's a fabricated thought. It's all made up. It's a Martian thought. Are you going to repent of it? Tell Jesus you're sorry. Lord, I'm so sorry. I sat and listened to made up, fabricated thoughts in my head. Come on, say it.
I'm sorry, I made up fabricated thoughts in my head, and I'm sorry.
I shouldn't listen to them. I repent of it. I stop listening to them right now. And I replace that thought with praise. Thank you, Jesus. I love you. I love you, dear Jesus. Tell him, keep going. Thank you, Jesus. I love you. Glory to God. Come on. Good girl. Keep going. Sydney, go. Praise your name, Lord. Praise your name, Lord. Glory to your name, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. There you go. Good. Good. Good girl. Come on, keep going.
Hey, will you make sure she gets a card and gets an appointment?
Card. Come on, sweetie, say it right now. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. I am not sick. It's all lies. I am not sick. It's all lies. Streamers, this is Brother Mike. I'll be back next Friday. 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern. You can catch tonight's teaching, The Island of Disappointments, on our YouTube channel and our Facebook page, Michael W. Smith. Next week, next Thursday, Brother Rick will be here for another powerful Holy Ghost service. See you next time.